Hello guys, Winston here. Welcome to the first of several videos about my quest to make the best medium-duty Shapeoko, basically ever. This was an idea I hatched up as I was moving out of my aunt's garage and I was contemplating the future of this. Hold. This ugly CNC enclosure. I don't consider it to be one of my better builds, but it really has been a very practical and useful creation. And with all the stickers and memories it's amassed, I'd feel kind of bad scrapping it. Here's the problem. These days, I value my limited free time quite highly. I want a CNC I can push harder and faster than a Shapeoko 3. But unfortunately, none of the XL form factor Shapeokos currently on the market will fit in this 48-inch wide enclosure. They're all too big, so if I'm going to save this chunky box and give it a new lease on life, I'm going to have to design and build my own custom CNC, a machine I'm dubbing the Frankenoko. Let's cut to Fusion 360 so I can give you guys a brief overview of the plan for the Frankenoko, and then I'll show you how I machine the first part for it. This gantry rail.
This is the original Shapeoko 3, and this is what I'm keeping from it. Yep, basically just the rails. These are arguably the most valuable part of the machine. Anyone can machine carriage plates or the plates for a Z-axis. No one has the equipment to shoot a custom aluminum extrusion in their garage. These are stronger than 80-20 profiles, and they pull double duty as both the machine structure and the foundation for the linear motion system. It's been the Shapeoko secret sauce for achieving value and versatility for over a decade. The rest of the parts that comprise the Frankenoko will be a combination of custom design parts and components from Carbide 3D's catalog. This is what that looks like. I can't stray too far from the original design. Using the original rails enforces certain constraints. At the end of each rail has to be a carriage plate. Between carriage plates and another rail will need to be V-wheels. What I can mess with are the relative positions between these components, and that comes down to personal preference. For example, I don't care about the spindle being able to overhang the front of the machine. The vast majority of people never use that capability on the Shapeoko 3 to do joinery and stuff. I can elect to offset the gantry further back on the Y-axis carriage plates. And if the carriage plates are a little narrower, that now gives me 18 plus inches of usable travel in the Y direction, rather than the original 16 inches advertised on the Shapeoko 3, all without growing the machine footprint. There's a lot of other little details that I could go on and on about for a whole video, like moving the Y-axis rails inboard and adding a hybrid table, but I'll talk about them when I get around to making videos about those respective parts. For the time being, let's focus on the gantry rail. Starting with a bone stock Shapeoko 3 XL rail, what changes do I need to make? The bare minimum I need to do is drill a couple holes so I can mount a homing switch on one end and use some socket head screws as hard stops. It would also be a good idea to put a little notch behind the X-axis homing switch so I can tuck the cabling through the rail like it's done on the Shapeoko 4. Now, that would make for a very boring video, so me being me, I also wanted to spice things up a bit, and what better way to do that than with a gratuitous hexagon-based lightweighting diet. This isn't the first time I've defaced a Shapeoko rail before. A couple years ago, I skeletonized a pair of 600mm rails by machining a trapezoidal truss-like pattern into them. I machined all the way through the walls because I thought that open look would be the coolest, most extreme interpretation of a minimalist Shapeoko aesthetic. But this time I'm doing it a little differently. Instead of cutting all the way through the walls of the extrusion, I'm going to leave a thin membrane of aluminum in each pocket, just a millimeter thick. That little bit of material I'm leaving will actually have an outsized impact on the torsional rigidity of the rail as a whole. It's the same reason a stretched canvas over a wooden frame can make an aircraft wing stronger, and why an isogrid is much stronger than a regular grid. Any deformation in the primary skeletal geometry creates tension in that skin. Aluminum, among many other materials, the honeycomb pocketed design on my gantry preserves significantly more of the rail's original strength than if I'd punched through the walls, while still reducing overall weight by 25%. Now, I know someone is thinking this. Didn't Tom Stanton go through a bunch of effort to add mass to his DIY CNC? Don't heavy CNCs cut better? Yes and no. In general, damping vibration is a good thing, and adding rigidity is as well. but if we look at the kinematic chain between my spindle and my frame, and you consider the rigidity of V-wheels and fiberglass-reinforced GT2 belt, the gantry losing a few pounds is kind of negligible in the grand scheme of things. The degree of ultimate rigidity desired should be balanced against the power and precision of the drivetrain. This rail will be just fine. Now, machining a rail like this today wouldn't be that difficult. The rail is a little over 1 meter long, and the Shapeoko 5 Pro has a 4-foot wide table. But I started this project over a year ago. The largest CNC I had access to at the time was a Shapeoko Pro, and its work area is only 33 inches wide. While I could have tried to tile this project by machining half of the rail at a time, and then sliding it through the Shapeoko's work area or flipping it around, multi-step operations like that introduce an extra point of failure and a degree of inaccuracy, no matter how small. I didn't want to take any chances. Machining the extrusion in one shot was the safest approach, and as it turned out, this rail could fit within a Shapeoko Pro XXL's work area if you turn it 45 degrees diagonally. The problem then becomes, how do you make sure your CNC cuts on the rail exactly where you need it to? A bit zero isn't going to cut it. Establishing the location of a corner is not good enough without establishing the orientation of the part. And this isn't a Datron. I can't just wave my hand over a computer and have the CNC measure my material and compensate for rotation automatically. So the solution is going to have to be a little more analog. I'm going to have to machine some sort of reference feature. What I planned to do was basically make a big rectangular pocket at a 45 degree angle to drop my rail into. Now, if I had just slapped a big sheet of MDF on the table and cut a diagonal channel through it, that would have been horrifyingly wasteful. It only takes 2 points to establish a line, so if instead I strategically placed 2 smaller islands of MDF on opposite corners of my table and cut locating features into those, that would be enough to positively locate my stock. This is the setup I had in Fusion to do just that. I modeled up 2 MDF placeholders that were slightly oversized to the actual pieces of MDF that I had. I drew a big rectangle at a 45 degree angle over everything and extruded that down to model the pocket for my rail. I also added some strategically placed holes that would be used for attaching clamps to my fixtures. From this 3D representation, I made 2 sets of toolpaths. The one I'd run first would bore out my clamping holes, the second set would machine the pocket for my rail. At the CNC, I first set up my MDF pieces at opposite corners of the work area, held down crudely with some clamps, and then I ran my hole-making program. These holes were sized for M6 threaded inserts because I didn't want to have to worry about constraining my clamps to sit directly above the T-slots in the hybrid table. And if I wanted to do this right, I would also need to install the threaded inserts from underneath the MDF so they wouldn't pull through. I marked where my MDF pieces sat as machined, flipped them over, and then countersunk the bottom of the holes. This would ensure that the MDF could still lay flat on my table without the threaded inserts sticking out the bottom of the holes. Then I flipped my MDF islands back over, aligning them to my marks. Since I hadn't cut out the pocket for the Shapeoko rail, this visually ascertained degree of accuracy was totally sufficient. The clamps I would be using could compensate for small variations in distance to the workpiece. I ran my pocketing program in the MDF and tested the fit of my rail. It was just barely snug, which was perfect. I clamped down on the Shapeoko extrusion and prepared to machine into it. The program for cutting out the face of my Frankenoko rail wasn't all that complex. The 3 major milestones in this setup are roughing, finishing, and chamfering all the pockets. The holes and other secondary features aren't really worth mentioning. For computational efficiency, I used a 2D adaptive toolpath for roughing everything out and not a 3D toolpath. 2D toolpaths generally calculate faster than their 3D counterparts because they work off a simple contour rather than looking at all the faces in the region and working backwards to identify a safe boundary for machining at each step down. I also leveraged patterning as much as possible since each pocket is identical to its neighbor. And while I had a 1/4-inch flat end mill loaded into the spindle, I would also use it to finish the floors and the walls of the pockets as I went along. And then of course I had to judiciously chamfer everything possible. The use of patterning here was less about minimizing calculation time and more about me not wanting to click on 60+ profiles. Here's how that plan played out at the CNC. The adaptive toolpath parameters I picked were ones I'd run before with a 1/4-inch single flute end mill. Nothing crazy or eye-popping like what Titans of CNC would try to pull, but they were proven and reliable for a Shapeoko. Exactly what you want when there's zero margin for error. At the end of the first set of toolpads, the CNC took a quick detour to add a notch on the right side of the rail. Then I swapped in an 1/8-inch end mill to bore some holes that I would tap for M6 threads by hand later. And then one more change to a 1/16-inch end mill to bore out the 2.5mm holes that would become M3 down the road. The chamfer toolpath was run in two passes to minimize the load on the spindle. The cosmetics of this part mattered to me, so taking a little extra time for a better surface finish was totally worth it. And to my great amazement, the program concluded with no drama. Now I just had to flip the rail over and repeat that miracle. To do this, I first had to open up the size of my pockets in the MDF to accommodate the V-grooves on the front of the Shapeoko rail. This is why I had to machine the front side first, even though it would probably have been better to machine the back side to start, since any small mistakes would be less visible. You can't unmachine MDF, so I had to work hold the narrower side of the rail first. With a fitment of my modified fixture confirmed, I prepared to run a slightly tweaked set of toolpaths specific to the features on the back of the rail. And since you know the gist of how I did the cam for this rail, I'll let the footage speak for itself. And now, to my great relief, I now have the coolest looking non-linear rail Shapeoko extrusion ever. It's lightweight, eye-catching, and perfectly suited for my evil plans. Total weight removed was just under 1 kg. In the next video, we'll talk in greater detail about some of the other design decisions behind the Frankenoko, and move on to manufacturing its carriage plates. Until then, however, thank you all very much for watching, and I'll be back soon with more CNC desecration and DIY nonsense.